I'm late, but I have to give him a minute. That's okay. We have to be televised. Great. Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to our Board of Education meeting, the general session. I hereby call to order the workshop meeting of the Teaneck Board of Education held Wednesday, May 6, 2015, in the Eugene Field Administrative Buildings. We are actually in the, not the Margaret Angeli room, but we are in the gymnasium. Adequate notice of this meeting has been sent to the record, the Suburbanite, filed with the municipal clerk of the Teaneck Township, and posted inside the Teaneck Board of Education, 1 Marison Street, on Friday, May 1st, 2015. Roll call, please.
Here.
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 No flag.
Thank you, Mr. Farnapo. We don't actually have a flag present, but let's please stand and salute.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much for that. We wanted, normally our workshop meetings are held in the Margaret Angeli Staff Development Room, but in order to accommodate our community and our public, we decided to move the meeting here in case we had guests. So therefore, we weren't quite set up like having our flag, but please forgive us. At this point in time, I'd like to review our goals. Goal number one, students attending the Teaneck Public Schools will acquire the skills, knowledge, and understanding to be successful in the 21st century. Goal two, teachers and administrators in the Teaneck Public Schools will acquire the skills, knowledge, and understanding necessary to support student achievement. Goal three, the environment in the Teaneck Public Schools will be safe and respectful, with students and adults appreciative of the unique contributions of members of the community. Goal four, the Teaneck Public Schools will communicate effectively with parents and with the community. Goal five, the Teaneck Public Schools provide funding for goals 1 through 4 and sustain school facilities while respecting community resources. And at this time, we'd like to turn it over to the superintendent for her report.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I have a short report this evening. I usually don't for workshop meetings, but we have a lot going on. So I just want to remind everybody that this is Teacher Appreciation Week, and countries around the world tend to designate a period of time during which their citizens show appreciation to teachers for the work that they accomplish in nurturing and educating generations of children. And in New Jersey, Teacher Appreciation Week is actually observed during a week in May, and this week is Teacher Appreciation Week. So on behalf of the Teaneck Board of Education and all the children who attend the Teaneck Public Schools, Mr. McHale and I would like to extend appreciation to district teachers and to teachers everywhere. We believe that great teachers play a vital role in children's lives, and sincerely thank Teaneck's teachers for their dedication and commitment to excellence. Along those lines, I would like to highlight the wonderful work that our instrumental music teachers do in educating our students musically. Sunday's concert band and jazz band program at Teaneck High School was really spectacular. Our music educators are dedicated to student success, and nothing really could illustrate that like the actual student performance that we saw on Sunday. Most of our graduating seniors started their music lessons in fourth grade, and it was a real pleasure to see and hear how much they have grown. And I emphasize hear how much they have grown from fourth grade. Mrs. Clara Williams, one of our board trustees, received her Master Board Member certification at the recent Bergen County School Board Association meeting. In addition to comprehensive training that a board member must have to become a Master Board Member, an individual is required to do the following, and Mrs. Williams met all these requirements. They have to earn a cumulative total of 40 credits. They have to attend academy programs in 7 different core areas. They have to attend at least 4 county meetings and 2 delegate assembly meetings. They have to attend at least 2 annual New Jersey School Board Association workshops, at least 1 full-day statewide program, and must not be adjudicated to have violated the School Ethics Act. So we're very proud of Mrs. Williams. I know the whole board, 8 board members were there last night to honor Mrs. Williams, and we need to make this part of our record. And also, along those same lines, Mr. Sebastian Rodriguez was also recognized at the meeting for becoming a certified board member, and to do this, to achieve that goal, he has to complete 20 credits of comprehensive training, and he did that very, very well. So congratulations to Mr. Rodriguez. Also, as if there wasn't enough to do on the school board, our board vice president, Javon Rice, is being honored this weekend by Studio B and the Teaneck High School Forum at their annual mother-daughter brunch. Mrs. Rice is to receive their Community Service Award. Also recognized as women of distinction are teachers for the district, Zion Conte, Dr. Antoinette Bush, and Mary Joyce Lackey. And further, special recognition will be given to Taylor Worrell Stith, daughter of Shelley Worrell, for her accomplishments as a Girl Scout Gold Award recipient. So if anybody's interested in going to the luncheon, the tickets are available at the Forum at Teaneck High School. And I want to close with recognizing Ryan Schombach, one of our Teaneck High School students. He achieved Eagle Scout status at his Court of Honors last Sunday. And Ryan worked with the Tenafly Nature Center on an environmental project to earn this recognition. He's an outstanding young man. He changed clothes and later performed with the concert band and with the jazz band at Teaneck High School. So I enjoyed seeing him earn his certificate as an Eagle Scout, and also enjoyed him playing both a brass instrument and the guitar at this event. So congratulations to Ryan. There's a lot more going on, but that concludes my report for this evening.
Thank you, Barbara. Howard?
Just to echo in part and briefly the comments that were just made on this sheet, I want to add my thank you to the teachers who are here this evening, as well as the teachers who are not here this evening. You do what you do, and if you do it, great, and we're appreciative. The students benefit from it. It's not just a week, it's all year long, so that recognition as well. And I do want to congratulate Ms. Williams, Mr. Rodriguez, Ms. Rice, because all of us give time and energy at board meetings, at committee meetings, at other situations and activities, but these three people go well beyond the scope of what's considered normal, maybe even what's considered rational. They do a heck of a lot, so I congratulate them. And regarding Mr. Ryan Schombach, you know, achieving an Eagle status is not just doing a service at a nature center. That's preceded by years and dedication, work, education, and knowledge, and as well as additional community service to even get to the point where you have to do a special service project. They're getting merit badges, which some people laugh about, but it's a recognition of individual activities that are just tremendous in scope, varied in what they do, and it's a special situation. Very few people reach the pinnacle of scouthood through their efforts. Most just don't even get close to it. So congratulations to him.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you, Howard. And our rich community is wonderfully blessed to have such great people that are committed. At this time, we'd like to have anyone speak to items on the agenda. If you would like to speak to any item that is on the agenda, and I'll repeat, on the agenda, please step up to the mic, give us your name and address, please, and you have 3 minutes, and Mr. McHale will be our timer. Thank you.
name is Zev Darek, Johnson Avenue, Teaneck resident. I've got a lot of questions, it's a long agenda. I'll try to keep it quick.
If you could make reference to the agenda items particularly that you're referring
to. Number 104, number 105, and number 106, the summer programs. It's the item number. These are the summer programs for, there's the pre-algebra, the global history, and the book club. I'm just trying to understand how you get the word out to 8th graders coming into 9th grade and how you know that this program is considered necessary for students entering into high school, and how is the success of this program measured, and how does one qualify to be one of the students, and what was the past history of performance of this program. Number 156, it states that you're providing payment for out-of-district students. I think this is a wording issue. I'm assuming that this is for in-district students who are receiving out-of-district services. Number 165 and 166, this is for the roof projects. This continues to 168 and 169. It says that there's changes to replace with GAF Timberline HD and to reducing the snow guards, and then to to give this project to a company to bid out, or to prepare the bids. So how are we, how was this already bid out if we didn't get a company to bid it? And why are we making changes to the bids? And is the snow guard reduction in line with the building department standards? Number 255, as a parent whose child has been in a classroom with Ms. Simpson, I would like to thank Ms. Simpson for her service. She was a dedicated and caring individual, and I wish her well in her retirement. Number 256 and 256 and 257, you have categories A and B. I was wondering how many people are in each of the categories. Number 261, I'd like to commend Sandra Beckford on her professionalism. Sandra is a tremendous asset to the district. And finally, number 269, the fundraiser. Are the listed personnel teachers, and is the $1,085 going to be deducted from the fundraising amount? And what is the fundraising goal total of this event? Thank you for your time.
Is there anyone else that would like to speak to any items that are on the agenda? Mr. Gerald Henry, come on down.
Change of agenda throws me off. Gerald Henry, 909 River Road, Teaneck, Teaneck Township Education Association President. Just want to speak to 257, our paraprofessionals, and even 256, and some of the other things. I know we're facing some cuts in the budget. You know, it's been a very difficult year going forward. I hope, based on some of the things we've been doing and some of the headway we've been making, that we can come to some sort of middle ground where we can go forward with a bright future because of all the great work that all these people have been giving for many, many years. I know, you know, Barbara, we've had some really positive meetings, and I hope we can continue to go forward with that, and just that we can expedite things, because I know time is of the essence, so to speak, and I feel like this is so loud, I'm sorry. But I just want to come up here and say that I hope we can move forward, spirit of cooperation, get everything done quickly, and, you know, really do what's best for the students in the district, because I know that's what we're all here for. Thank you very much.
Hi. My name is Dr. Danielle Beidelman, and I would like to speak to the same item on the agenda, number 257, that the board accept the following recommendations from the superintendent regarding paraprofessional personnel, and the question about whether each will be offered employment in the upcoming school year. I would just like to say a few words about that. I would like to voice my support for keeping the current paraprofessionals in the classroom. Paraprofessionals that are hired by the district are invested in the TNEC school system, and many have been here for a number of years. They are familiar with our children and have worked in their classrooms. They have worked on the buses with them and have even served as camp counselors. It helps our children to feel more calm and safe when they are assisted by familiar faces. Our children who have special needs need to be in an environment with special people. It is essential that these people are dedicated to their jobs and have a strong sense of commitment to the children and the community that they serve. Powers hired by the district will have stricter educational requirements and standards than having staff which is outsourced, which I feel will lead to a decreased quality of education for our children. It is also important for children with special needs to have a routine and consistency in order for them to make the most progress. Outside agencies may not provide adequate compensation or incentives in order to retain their staff, and we may be faced with a higher turnover rate and a less stable support system for our teachers who need the aides to provide more individualized attention for our students. Another important factor is that children are entitled to receive an education in the least restrictive environment, and successful inclusion in the classroom requires that teachers have access to support in terms of a para. My child is actually going through a transition of sorts, and after having an extremely rough second grade year, he was placed in a self-contained classroom, and in the first environment where he was, he didn't have the proper supports, and after having proper supports at this time, he is now being transitioned into a regular education classroom for math, and this transition is being made more smooth with the assistance of his para. He is very excited, and I am also very excited. Again, I would just like to say that I am in favor of retaining the current para professionals that we have in the district instead of hiring staff from unknown entities. Thank you.
Good evening, board, all the members and attendees here.
Excuse me, ma'am, could you please state
to our children that decided to accompany us.
Thank you. Could you please state your name?
My name is Carol Jones.
And your address, please.
I am at 55 Irvington Road here in Teaneck. I have been, I went to school here. My family first purchased the home here in 1972. I just wanted to say that I don't want to take but a minute of your time, that I agree with everything the parent that just came before me. Her son is in my son's class. My son, Glenn Jones, who's sitting over, hi, Glenn, went through the very same thing. I'm asking you, we're beseeching you at this point, please, please reconsider that decision to outsource the paras. Our children need them, especially our, you know, all of our children need them, but especially our special needs children, whom, you know, this has been like a roller coaster ride for them, and been like a turnaround has been made for them with the help of the paras that are, like I said, I can't say enough good stuff about them. I buy them gifts for when I go on vacation. I bake them some cookies because what they're doing for our children. My son was turning over desks in school in the general education class without a para and that support. He was throwing stuff at the teacher. He was running out the classroom. All of that has turned around since the paras that are in place now, you know, paras like Mr. Badges, Mr. Smith, and to name a few, came into his life and just turned it around for him. Now he comes home, he's happy. I don't get that dreaded phone call. You know, hello, please come to the school right away because your son's in the office now and he's under the table, he's crying, he's screaming, he's kicking, he's trying to run out to school. I just need you guys to reconsider this. You just think for a second what it means to our kids. I know we're all in this together. We all care about what happens to our kids. And I just need you to reconsider that decision and hold them in place because of the good, the contribution that they've made to our community, to our kids, to our town, is outweighs any negative or detrimental effect that I feel like them leaving would have on our community. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have a final comment. We're just about to wrap up this portion of our meeting and we're going to be moving on to our agenda.
Thanks, Jervon. I just want to say, as a physical educator in this town for the last 17 years and as a taxpayer in this town for the last 15 years.
I'm sorry. I know
Linda Harrison.
Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry. Terhune Street, Tina. Because most of you all know where I am anyway, but, you know, I'll just say it. But I have to give kudos to our paraprofessionals. And like Ms. Jones spoke to, and Ms. Biedelman spoke to, Dr. Biedelman, thank you. I've worked with Barbara Ann Walker. I've worked with many paraprofessionals. I've been in Lowell, Hawthorne, Whittier. And I can tell you that the level of professionalism goes without say. And I have worked with Mission One people. And some of the Mission One people are really fantastic. And some of them, I would say most of them, need some work. But as an educator in this town that is concerned with our public education in this town, we know that public education is the most important thing. It is a great equalizer. And Ms. Rice, you know, I had your kids too, so you know what kind of educator I was. And I worked with Ms. Pinsack. She was my first principal. I worked with Mr. McHale, another principal. They know the level of quality and care that goes into my curriculum as a phys ed teacher. And when we start talking about special education and incorporating that into what we're doing, and phys ed is one of the areas where the kids are mainstreamed, right? And we know that, for social reasons and everything else. I have seen great strides with our kids, and I have to say that some of those heights that those kids reached would not have been reached had it not been for people like Barbara Ann Walker walking into the gym every day, whether she had high heels on or sneakers on and was ready to go. She was right there with the kids, and Mr. Smith and Ms. Chappell, and those are just to name a few. I can only say that I feel very strongly as a taxpayer, so I'm paying the same taxes that all of everybody else in town is paying. And I'm a teacher in this town, and I respect the board's decision, but I know it's a hard decision. I know fiscally you guys are between a rock and a hard place. But I will say this. Our paraprofessionals, bar none, are probably some of the best people that I have ever worked with in our TNEC Education Association and in our program. And thanks for letting me just say that.
Thank you, Ms. Harris.
Harrison.
Harrison.
Coach.
First, we're just going to have a few responses from our superintendent and assistant superintendent to some of the things, the questions that were asked.
And if we don't respond to everything, we will probably, as we go through the agenda with the board, we'll be reminded and we can respond. to these. I just want to talk about the potential outsourcing of the paraprofessionals, because this is not based on performance, and nobody is happy about this. This is based on the fact that there are limited resources, and because we're a service organization, and I certainly do not make an apology for that, we're all about service, 70% of our budget is in salaries. So this is a matter of $1 million+, and where we've taken cuts in our school budgets, we've taken cuts in our central office budget, we've taken cuts in administrators, we've taken cuts in teaching staff personnel, which, by the way, keeping programs and teaching staff is a priority of the state of New Jersey, and we could, be sanctioned for that. And so we're not happy about that at all. We have about 100 district paras, or 100 paras in the district, and 60 of them are Mission 1 paras, and 39 of them are classroom instructional paras that are district paras. So that's kind of the fact of the matter. And over the last couple of years, we have added, where we've added a new position, it has been through an outsourced company called Mission 1. And I agree with Ms. Harrison, because some of the Mission 1 paraprofessionals are outstanding. Now, we're not going to be cutting services to children in terms of personnel. If a child has a service, has a one-to-one para, or has a para in the classroom, that by IDEA regulation, that will remain. Where there are concerns about quality or hiring of paraprofessionals, I think I've already made the statement that we are committed, dedicated to do as much as we need to do with Mission 1 or any other outsource, any other company, if we need to go to another company, because there's a question of quality, to get the quality that TNEC students deserve. We're all dedicated to the quality that TNEC students deserve, but we have hit a ceiling in terms of funding. It's as painful, as complicated, and as simple as that. We have hit a ceiling, a $2.8 million ceiling. And since 70% of our budget is in salaries and benefits, that's the bulk of the budget. We have programs that are mandated. IDEA programs are mandated. Charter school is mandated. Other things are mandated, so we have very little play. It's not play, but very little leeway in terms of our budget. This has not been an easy thing to do. Now, Mr. Henry mentioned that we had some meetings, and we have had some meetings, and we have worked some figures. Our business administrator, Dr. Frohnapple, has worked some figures. We've traded figures and such with the TTA, and not to put Mr. Henry on the spot, I believe the last series of numbers, I shouldn't say figures, numbers, went to the TTA to look at. So not a happy time. Not a happy time to be sitting in this chair, not a happy time to be sitting where some of the parents are sitting, but all I can tell you is we will do our absolute best, however this turns out, to provide the very best quality education that we can for TNEC students. Do you think I pretty much answered that? Is there anything I should add?
No, I think that was pretty much, unless anyone else had anything else to add. Vincent, or anything, not about that topic particularly. Howard, did you want to speak to that particular topic? Because we're going to.
Thank you. First of all, I want to state that I agree with what's been said by many of you, that we receive from district employees and para positions excellent service, professional service, desirable service. Any statement you want to make, that's pretty true. It's terrific. And their loss will have an impact. I see no two ways about that. I'm on record as being against using paras, and I've made the statement many times that outsourcing is another term for saying firing. And while they will have an option, I assume, of coming in under the auspices of another company at lesser remuneration, it doesn't resolve a lot of people's problems. I'm also on record of being against the budget for many factors, and oddly enough, I'm not just a trustee. I'm also one out of four committee members on the Finance Committee, and I'm still against it because I feel that what we're dealing with right now treats some areas unfairly, other areas fairly, and I'm concerned that what's been going on the last months, where have people been to give us ideas and help us out with these situations over a period of time? Not at the last moment. We're at the 11th hour. No, we're actually at the 12th hour right now. And things are coming to an end because they're being finalized. And it's not just what's gone on in the last few months. It's what's gone on for the last multiple years. It's put us where we are now. It didn't happen yesterday. It's happened over a long period of time. My biggest concern is that neither the community nor myself can come up with a good idea that says, let's not be in the space we're in because we can do what? What can we do? And I don't have an answer for that, and I haven't heard answers for that. I deal with eight other trustees who have different ideas on how to attack the budget problem, and it is a problem. There's consensus, there's majority rule, there's some disquiet within the ranks, as you're probably aware. And I'm concerned that we're coming in with power replacements from an unknown company. Well, it's not just, not unknown, but I'm sorry, unknown in terms of what the qualities it'll provide for these types of positions for the new ones. We see what happens already in terms of the old ones, good, bad, it's all over the board, and for the most part, we're getting good service. You may even think that some of the employees that are working with your children now are district employees, when the reality is they're not, because we do get excellence. I have no doubt that they're going to be in compliance with what we need and what you need and what your child needs. So I don't think that's a real concern. And in response to the statement of, you know, cookies, you don't resolve these problems with a bake sale. You resolve it with taxes. And you know what? We've maxed out. And that's where it lies.
So I can answer Mr. Derrick's question about our summer programs that are being offered at the high school for our incoming ninth graders. And in fact, the program is offered, those three programs are offered to all of the incoming ninth graders. Once the board has approved that the programs will take place, all students who are registered for those courses will receive a letter inviting them to participate in the program. It's open to every student who is enrolled in the course, and this is the second year that we will be offering all of those programs. 2 years ago, well, we've had the book club for a number of years under started under the direction of Ms. Pinsak, and then the global history program was offered for 1 year, and then we've added the algebra and extended the global history to every student. This year we have been following the performance of the students in the courses throughout the year, and at the mid-year point it did show that students who had participated were performing well, and we'll make a further assessment of that at the end of the year. But those, not all of the students select to participate, and in comparing the students who did with students who didn't, especially at the beginning of the year, they had a very strong transition into the high school, and then the students were surveyed and said that they felt that the program made them feel really confident about starting on that first day because they had already been to the high school, they had met teachers, and they were familiar with the expectations that teachers would have for them academically, and that it really prepared them well.
As to the term of out-of-district students, that is the term that is used. They are out of the, because they are receiving their education out of district. So you can certainly email me, or we can talk about that. But that is the term that the technical term for it.
Some of the items, if they weren't addressed just yet, they will be addressed as we move through the agenda. So hopefully you'll be patient with that part of the process. Okay, so let us move through our agenda. And if any other comments by board members, feel free to make your comments at that time. Mr. Duguid? Well, first, let's go through. Normally, it's a little strange because this is just our workshop meeting. So the good part about you being here is that you get to hear the actual conversation of the board, the going through the agenda items and having the conversation, whereas normally when it's a public session, we've already had the discussion and we're just voting. So at this point in time, we just go through each page and have clarity or questions to the superintendent, assistant superintendent, or just have discussion about any of the agenda items. So first we will begin with page 3. If there's any questions or comments.
Just a comment regarding the second meeting of April 8th. In the details, which I don't see here, but they may be buried deeper, it was mentioned that the vote held on the budget, there were 8 affirmations and 1 vote of no, and that Dr. Gruber was the vote of no. In fact, it was Howard Rose who was the vote of no, not Mr. Gruber.
Thank you for the point of clarity, and you would have found that in the notes that were forwarded to you electronically. Oh. So they're not here, but they would have been forwarded to you in your board packet that you received. So I'm sure that Mr. Farnop will make note of that adjustment. Page 4. Any question or comment? Yeah, Vincent, if you could just elaborate on the textbooks and curriculum.
So this is a motion about adopting new textbooks for the 15-16 school year in social studies, language arts, and in science and mathematics. And these books are needed. Some of the content areas had not had textbook or resource replacement in a number of years, and I did provide to the board a description of the vetting process, how the books were selected. There was input from teachers in committees, and then often for many of them also in department meetings. There was a parent textbook committee held on March 26th, and there was a small number of parents who did end up showing up. There were more parents invited but indicated they would come, but unfortunately they were unable to come. But a parent team did review the textbooks, and overall the comments that they had were that the books seemed suitable, and the books are available for review by the board. If you would like to come to curriculum instruction office, we have them available for your further review.
Mm-hmm. Can you speak into your mic?
On the specific statement, I'm wondering if there's a price tag that should or could be appended to that item number 9-6.
I can provide you, I can have for you next week the cost of the books. I believe, and Dr. Fronapple can correct me if I'm wrong, the books do fall below the threshold amount that needs to go to bid, but we can provide the amounts to you.
I'm looking at the your report on the agenda on the textbook update. Yes. And I see with the Criminal Justice Today textbook, there are 2 comments. One parent said the pictures are great. Let me see if I'm looking at the graphics and style are great. It's very engaging and relevant, which is a good comment. The second comment seems to be a little bit more stronger in nature. And I'm not sure if it's necessarily against the book, but the comments vary. Obviously, one person likes the graphics and the style. The other person feels, how they're being interpreted in the book are not consistent with the way in this person's culture. They should be portrayed, and so I'm trying to figure out when 3 parents show up and you get their comments, how is that weighted to determine, if the book should be adopted by the district, based on each comment from the parent.
So I can address that. I did include, the parents have a rating on a whole variety of categories in which they're encouraged to review the book, and the supervisors who are recommending the texts after the teachers have gone through and have looked at a variety of texts along with the supervisor. They're looking at the text in a variety of ways: the content, how it's presented, is it appealing, are there a variety of cultural backgrounds represented in the images and in the discussions in the text. And for this particular text, the parent, so to clarify that, in the letter A heading underneath each text, I indicated where the ratings fell. So for the criminal justice book, most of the ratings in the evaluation criteria were at the good or excellent level. And there were two ratings of fair, one for captions and one for the inclusion of equity and diversity. And that was specific to the parents' concern that there were representations of the Islamic culture in the book. However, she felt that the way that some of the Hudud crimes were presented in the book was not in keeping with the common practice that that American American Muslims would believe. And so, as a matter of fact, the parent volunteered that when the class gets to that section in the book, she has volunteered to come and speak to the class and share her perspective on that issue. So she said that it was not an issue that was specific or germane just to this text, but she said in general in the United States it's that presentation that's common, and she wanted to counter that with a different perspective.
I'd like to add. I want to remind the board and the public that our textbooks are good resources for us, but they're not the curriculum. So the supervisor in this case and in any other case took note of that, and as they rewrite the curriculum and develop the revise the curriculum, they will include that point of view, that very good point that the parent made, and as well as others.
Good. And I think that it's important that we continue to offer that as an opportunity, and perhaps any parents here would make sure that they avail themselves of the BQMT at your individual school as well as the district BQMT, so that the parents do have a right to have input. But of course, that was after the teachers had input as well. So because we have such rich culture in our community, it's wonderful that this parent is able to then supplement. As you mentioned, Barbara, that it's more than just the textbooks. So no further questions on page 4. Moving on to page 5.
Mm-hmm. Sure. So I want to speak to 98 under school op and curriculum, the equivalency waiver application. We are asking the board to support my recommendation that we apply for equivalency waiver application to the Department of Education. And so if granted, where a tenured teacher has an effective or highly effective rating for 2 years, I believe it is, just from the previous year, that we can, currently we're doing 3 short observations of 20 minutes each, and we're asking for the waiver to do 1 long observation of 40 minutes and 1 short observation of 20 minutes. And this was presented to the District Advisory Committee, the DAC Committee, for Teacher Observation and Evaluation, actually Administrator Observation and Evaluation too. And also a survey was given to the administrators and to the teachers, and the majority and strong majority of the teaching staff and the administrative staff were in favor of applying for this equivalency waiver. And it really is the time spent in observation is the same, but the feeling was that with people who were effective or highly effective, to add that qualitative 40-minute observation with deeper discussion would be very helpful for tenure staff members. So we are hoping that the board supports my recommendation for that.
Okay. I was going to ask a question about but you answer my question. excuse me, but it says attach. It's supposed to be a document attached to the agenda?
It was in the attachment that was sent to you.
Yeah.
Electronic version. Yeah, and as a matter of fact, I recall seeing in the electronic version that we received, it mentioned that it would reduce the total number of observations, which are currently about 320 some odd, which is a lot of observations. So it reduces the, and in total, I hear you, Vincent, saying over 1,200 evaluations. So not that the quality would be diminished, but it probably would be richer observations in the sense of the quality of time. Any further discussion? Sarah.
I'm the representative to the DAC committee, and I think the other thing that we discussed in the committee was, well, two things. One is this especially makes sense in the high school where the classes are 85 minutes long. To have one of the two observations be a 40-minute observation when the classes are normally 85 minutes long makes a lot more sense. And then the other issue that we just, you know, the teachers were concerned, are these going to be, are we going to try to schedule the longer 40-minute observations to be the announced observations? And I believe Mr. McHale said that he would do his best to do that, but it was some of it was going to be based on just getting them all scheduled.
Thank you, sir. And just as in terms of our acronyms, the DAC was the District Advisory Committee, and the BQMT is the Building Quality Maintenance Committee. The building quality management team. And again, these are opportunities where, as Sarah mentioned, it's comprised of teachers, administrators, as well as parents. And so it's a great opportunity to have input from all constituents of our community. Moving on, no further on page 5, we'll move on to page 6. Any comments, questions?
Item 100. The programs of the forum, are some of them or all of them available to all students in TNAC?
Some of the programs are available to all of the students in TNAC.
As most programs of the forum are, right?
Thank you, Jervon. Most of the programs at the forum are available to all of the students in TNEC. If there's something during the day, you know, that's not the case. But that would tend to be at the middle schools, and most of the forum programs are at the high school.
I just wanted to speak to item number 102, that this is, looks like a good summer program, the Children's Defense Fund, again, working with the forum. I don't know if we could elaborate a little bit further, but I find it in the explanation very interesting that the funds must address the teen parents and or father engagement, which I think is a very valid and formative and important topic with our youth today. I don't know if there's any further comment or explanation.
This, I believe, is relatively new, isn't it? This yeah. Opportunity, and you know, we have a magnificent forum, and while funds have been flat over the last few years, we actually did gain a small amount of additional funds this year because of the excellence of the forum. So this is a relatively new program for the forum, and we will be able to tell you more about the program once we've initiated, once we've actually had it and vetted it, but having the confidence that we do in our forum personnel led by Nick Campestra, we know that it's going to be, what we feel it's going to be, another slam dunk. So I'm looking forward to giving you some more information about this.
I just also wanted to speak to item number 104, 105, 106, that I know that we had talked in previous times about making sure that there was a good supportive system for transition into our high school and to make sure that we gave a good foundation of success. So happy to see that we are able to continue these items, the pre-algebra summer enrichment, as well as the global history. And I'm happy to see that our parent that asked about the success, the quality, and the history of performance, because those are things that they're fairly new programs, but as a request to make sure that we're giving a good firm foundation with transition, and I think that we'll find that we have continued success following through that. Moving on to page 7. And then on page 7, which leads to 8 and 9, which is just the readoption ratifying of our curriculum for the 2015-2016 school year.
I'd like to speak to that.
And Vincent, thank you.
So this is a readoption of our curriculum, but I do want to alert the board that there is a recent directive from the Department of Ed that many curriculum documents need to have a new born-on date, which means that they're interested in seeing that every curriculum document for the ones they're naming have been gone through carefully in the summer and that they align with all of the curriculum standards from the Common Core State Standards as well as the New Jersey Core Curriculum Content Standards. And so we will be engaging in that project, and at the end of the summer we will see another not a readoption, but a new adoption of those documents. And so this is readoption of anything that does not need to be changed, but at the end of the summer we'll see another item on the agenda that will say adoption, and it's to provide verification that those curriculum documents meet the standards that the state is asking us to meet. We're confident that they do. We just went through CUSAC this year, and the curriculum that they inspected, for lack of a better word, did meet all of those requirements. So they did scrutinize for several hours. So just to alert you that we will have another item, and we will have the curriculum committee meet to be further briefed on those items.
So we'll have those born on dates listed when that comes forth. Okay, good. Sebastian.
I have to apologize, but I want to go back to 6, item 103, and then item 107. And I just want to share the fact that, you know, as a member of the Finance Committee, I know we discussed this at length, but, you know, I know we are adding a lot of summer programs, but it's also, at least to me, and I know some members of the Finance Committee, and I know the Superintendent and others, that, you know, eliminating extracurricular activities and programs also has a tremendous effect on the education of our students. So, you know, I'm a strong believer in supporting after school and extracurricular programs, and, you know, difficult to have to eliminate, you know, 2 elective courses from the middle school, and yet on 107, we are able to donate 24 tickets to Bergen PACS for students who are interested in art. So it's kind of difficult to you know, do everything at once, but I just want to, mention that you know, it's something that we agreed to do, but it's not something, and I know for myself, it's not a good decision.
Yeah, no, we're not happy about it either, and we know that we have magnificent arts programs for our students and how important they are to our students. We did this after you know, a couple of things. This wasn't, as you know from a dart thrown at a dartboard, but we did check other middle schools in the county and beyond the county, and just to see, to make sure that, to find out what offerings they had at the middle school level. And we did do a review of students who elected to take those electives, so that had something to do with the decision. And in addition, while it isn't the same thing, through the community education program, we do plan to offer dance to our students in the middle school after school and an after school club or activity, not suggesting that it's the same thing. And we do plan to increase by a small amount the stipend for school play at the middle school, in hopes that we'll get 5th through 8th grade students involved in a school play the way so many, you know, in a production tailored on a small scale after our wonderful high school productions. And that's about the most that we feel we can do. While it's not a replacement,
but it is important because there's a lot of research that shows that supporting extracurricular activities, quality activities, have not the same impact, but it's just as beneficial to the growth of our students. So I'm glad we're doing that on the side. Thank you.
Good. I just want to thank the Finance Committee as well as the Superintendent for at least coming up with an alternative, because in TNEC, I know we've always prided ourselves on the arts and making sure that we have exposure. And to your reference to the tickets, that those were indeed donated by Bergen PAC, item 107, that they donated those 24 tickets. And Vincent can elaborate on that. Thanks, Vincent.
So this is a new program that is at, and I did mention this at another board meeting, because this is the second time that the Bergen PAC is donating those tickets to us. Turn back to the page. The Bergen PAC Access Program, and so they've donated tickets to us once before. They donated 24 tickets on our last month's agenda, and they've selected to donate them again. And at the school, the principal is distributing the tickets to students who have demonstrated academic growth during the year or academic success. And it's so the teachers make those recommendations and then the tickets are given out. So 48 tickets will have been given out in the district based on the generosity of this program.
Okay, so you have your second chance on page 7 or page 8. Page 9, which also is inclusive of the readoption of our curriculum. And now we're on to page 10. Comments, questions? Moving on to page 11. On to item page 12. All right, we'll slow down a little bit. Clara.
I just want to talk about the item 154 and some of the student field trips. If you read the detail of some of these items, I'm at least happy that our students continue to get exposure to various other venues and fine art programs, etc. And I think that we are trying to continue to expose our kids and develop well-rounded children. Given the constraints, the financial constraints that we are facing these days.
I just want to make mention, very special mention to our PTOs, which often do a lot of the fundraising that fund those extracurricular field trips and things. So most of those are not usually district funded, but through the generosity and hard work of the parents that sell all those cookies and candies and bake sales to try to help fund those things. Barbara? Things. They definitely deserve an applause because we're all harassed to buy all those things, right? And we try to always support, so thanks
healthy,
for that.
And the healthy snacks.
And the healthy snacks, that's right. That's right, right? Always has to be the healthy. Okay, so moving on, page, that was 11, page 12. I just noticed here on page 12 and 13 we have our annual the emergency bus drills that take place, and that takes up most of our page 12. 13. I just wanted to comment really quick on page 13, 164, toilet tissue. I always tell people that when I signed up for the board, I had a real issue and a mandate for quality education, but you have to take all the package, including approving toilet paper. So our job is really an important one, where we, whether it's something you really care about, like we have to do waivers for the kindergarten toilets, toilet paper, all that still comes with our position. You have to take care of all the issues that come along with it. Moving on to page 14, you've got to have some humor, right?
Madam Chair, we're going to respectfully request that the board take action on these five motions on finance and budget 165 through 169. I'd like to review them briefly, each one, so that you know where we are with them. These have to do with the roof replacements at the Bryant and Hawthorne School. And also the waste removal services and the hiring of the professional services contract to oversee the roof installations. 165, now we bid these roofs twice, late in February, early March, and then again at the end of March. And 165 is that the board acknowledged the receipt and opening of bids for the roof replacement at Bryant Elementary School, and they were done on Thursday, March 26th, and that the board award a contract to the lowest responsible bidder for the roof replacement at Bryant Elementary Schools. Now, we had a total of 8 vendors that requested bids, and 6 of those vendors submitted bids. The lowest bidder was, of course, Northeast Roof Maintenance Incorporated. Their base bid was $919,000. As a result of submitting that bid, the architects got together with the professional services folks at ARM, and they looked about where they might be able to save some additional monies. And they came up with the idea that they can use a different shingle, a lesser expensive shingle, that would be just as good, have a 40-year warranty in lieu of the specified shingle that was in the contract. And by doing that, it reduced the base bid by $10,675. They also looked at another area that the original plan called for installing snow guards at shingle roof areas, and they decided that that was really only needed to be done over the entranceways. And by doing just the entranceways, it reduced the base bid again by another $7,500. So as a result of those two reductions, which will not impair the integrity of the new roof at all, you're saving close to $18,000. So the adjusted contract amount to Northeast Roof Maintenance is $900,825, and the award would be for the unit price, and these are contained in the specifications, 1, 2, 3, and 4, as per their proposal. As I said earlier, 8 vendors requested bids, 6 vendors submitted bids. And it is incumbent upon the board to award it to the lowest responsible bidder. 166, that the board acknowledged the receipt and opening of bids for the roof replacement project at Hawthorne Elementary School. This was done on Friday, March 27th. Again, that the board award a contract to the lowest responsible bidder for the roof replacement at Hawthorne Elementary School. Again, there were 8 vendors that requested bids, 6 submitted bids. The lowest was E.R. Barrett Incorporated, a base bid of $1,123,250. Again, the architects got together with the maintenance, with the professional services folks, to look over to see where possible reductions might be made to save the district a few dollars. Again, the shingles area, they're going to install different shingles with a 40-year warranty instead of the specified one, reducing the base bid by $19,370. And again, they looked at the snow guards, just putting them over the entranceways, and that further reduced the bid by $15,550. So we're talking about close to $35,000 less from the base bid. Adjusted contract amount to E.R. Barrett was now $1,088,330, along with the awarding of the unit price number 1, 2, 3, 4, as per their particular proposal. Again, 8 vendors requested bids, 6 submitted bids. 167, is that the board acknowledge the receipt and opening of bids for trash removal services for the 15-17 school year. This would be a two-year base contract. These bids were opened on Thursday, April the 9th. And the board award a contract to the lowest responsible bidder, which was Bella Cleaning and Carting, LLC, Services. Three vendors requested bids, and three vendors submitted bids. And again, it is the board that must award the lowest responsible bidder by resolution in accordance with the code. 168 is that the board award a professional services contract to ARM Associates, Incorporated, for the preparation of plans, specifications, bid, and contract administration services for the roof project at Hawthorne Elementary School, not to exceed $52,200. 169, that the board award a professional services contract to ARM Associates for the preparation of plans, specifications, bid, and contract administration services for the roof project at Bryant Elementary School. The hiring of these monitoring folks, in the end, saves the district a lot of money. These are professional folks. They know their jobs. They make sure that the folks installing the roofs do it correctly, properly, in accordance with the terms and conditions of the bid, and in accordance with the terms of those guarantees that we have for those roofs. So those are the five resolutions, Madam Chair, 165 through 169.
Thank you, Mr. Frohnapple, Dr. Frohnapple. Just a quick question. Item number 167, it says that the bid tabulation was appended. Was that in our electronic notes? Because I don't see it here. Was that forwarded?
I don't think it was, Madam Chair.
So do we have the bid tabulation sheet?
We have the bid. They're up in the business office. And usually for trash removal, I looked at the last one. They weren't included. Okay. On the list, but we can actually list them on this and have them for next week.
Yeah, just so that we know, each of the other items were noted, and in fact, it's nice to see that despite the fact that we are required by law, 18A, to go with the lowest bidder, that those low bids even did find us additional savings, so that was nice to see, but it would be nice just to have the open bids and for full disclosure to have the actual rates.
We'll make those additions.
Thank you. Any other questions, comments on what was presented? Clara?
Quick comment. I just, you know, I fully support our capital improvements or maintenance because of the fact that providing clean, dry, well-maintained facilities for our students is very important because they spend so much of their day as well as years in these buildings, and so I think that we absolutely have to commit these funds to doing this work so that, you know, we have roofs that don't leak and, again, facilities that are, you know, reflect how we feel about educating our kids.
Thanks. Clara, any other comments? Sure,
Barbara. Dr. Frohnapple, would you remind the board and speak to maybe some of the public who hasn't been at all the meetings about the percentage from the state for these projects?
These roof projects, we applied for a state grant, and the district was awarded a state grant, so that the state will be providing up to 40% of total cost, with the rest of the percentage coming from local funding. Mm-hmm. And that is becoming from the school's development authority. Those grants have been approved, and once we start construction, then we will be drawing down those funds. So 60% is being paid by the state, and the rest from the local funds.
40. Yeah. We wish that it was 60% by the state, but
did I say the other word? Isn't that wishful thinking?
I know, but thank you.
From my lips to Trenton's ears.
Yes, maybe you have an inside track, Dr. Frohnapple.
40% state, 60% local.
Because we could certainly use the difference.
We certainly could.
And it's my understanding then that we're finishes for 25 years or so, or 40 years, or whatever it is, the roofing projects that looked so dire a few years ago. It looked like it was going to be very, very hard to take care of the roofs that were in, that were way over extended warranty.
Thanks, Barbara, and thanks, Claire, for your point of maintaining our building, because as we all know, that our buildings are very old. Some of us here actually went to these schools, so we know that they're very old.
And
so
it's older than
and even older than us. So it is important to maintain the quality and preserve the investment of the community. Okay, so there's any no other further question or comment, then we are going to be voting, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Madam Vice President, I'd like to move Finance and Budget Motions 165 through 169.
I'd like to second that.
Any further discussion? Roll call.
All right, we have a motion and a second for Finance and Budget Resolutions 165 through 169. Dr. Duguid?
Yes.
Mrs. Rappaport?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Mr. Rose?
Yes.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Ms. Worrell?
Yes.
Mrs. Rice?
Yes.
So moved.
Thank you. And then, Dr. Funapple, any other further discussion about the next motion? Or David, would someone like
I think we'll do that after the budget presentation.
Budget presentation.
Yes.
Okay, great. So let's move on. Page 17. I'm sorry. Jumping ahead. Page 16.
May I respond to the question on 266?
Yes, please.
This is a response to the question on 266. I'm sorry, 256. A, approximately 60, and B, approximately 11.
Any further questions, comments? Page 16. Page 17. Yeah, I was going to mention on item 259, Vincent, maybe you could elaborate the expense here, that it certainly is not encumbered by the district, but by the individuals.
So as a requirement of the State Department of Education Certification Office, when we have teachers who are, when they graduate from college, they no longer receive a permanent teaching certificate, they receive a provisional certificate. And for the first year of their employment, those teachers need to be assigned a mentor within the district. And the regulations say that the teacher, the provisional teacher, must pay the fee for the mentor, that the district is not permitted to pay that, but must serve as a pass-through. So in the past, I know when I had a mentor, I just gave the mentor the money, or some mentors said, I don't even want the money, and were very generous and kind. But the state says that that cannot happen, that the district must collect the money from the provisional teacher and then pay it out to the mentor teacher. And so those amounts that are listed there are just passing through our finance office, and they're not incurred by our general fund.
Thanks, Vincent. Okay, no other further questions there. On to page 18. Page 19.
On 267, this is, as we've seen in the past, we have a world language teacher at the high school who's on leave at the current time. We could not find a qualified substitute to take the teacher's classes, so we've ask our teachers at the high school to respond, you know, to this, and we looked at their schedule, so these teachers would provide coverage for that that class while the teacher is out, for the duration of the time that the teacher is out.
Are we good? And page 20.
I can, it's 269. So, in response to the question about 269, this is district funding. The amount for the of remuneration for the personnel to chaperone is not going to be taken out of the fundraiser profits.
Oh, Sarah? Barbara, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is a fundraiser basically run by the students. The teachers are there as chaperones, and it's money that the class fundraises from junior year on to help defray the cost of their prom. Am I correct?
Yes, that and other expenses, yes.
Okay, so that concludes our agenda review. And we did have public comment on that already. So now at this point in time, believe it or not, we're going to still have discussion about our budget. We have a public hearing at this point in time. And I believe Mr. Farnapa has a presentation. Yeah, board members, you may wish to sit on the other side so that we can see. And I just want to thank Dr. Farnapple, who is our interim BA, who has indulged us and our community numerous times in giving further explanation. And as we continue to tweak and make the hard decisions that none of us want to make, but we have continuously looked at this.
This is the recess period. We serve that at the end. Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the board, Madam Superintendent, Mr. Assistant Superintendent, members of our community. For those of you that have been following me, you know this budget presentation better than I do. Like a couple of days ago, on the weekend, I got up in the morning, I was getting dressed, and my wife gets a hold of me, she says, Dennis, what the hell were you talking about in the middle of the night about bank cap? You got to do the bank cap, you got to do the bank cap. I said, it's a long story, I said, but I'll tell you someday when I got time. So I've really been living this budget. All right, this is the public hearing for the 15-16 school year budget. And we're going to take you through a few items and try to educate you on how the process works. Now, this is our revenues, and we've had this chart up here. We do a pie chart to show you that biggest piece of the pie, of course, is your local taxes. So it's you folks, your local folks, that are funding almost 91% of this total budget. And then the budget is made up from a few other parts. We have the second one. Is state aid. State aid, $6,401,235. Now, how does that come down? Well, we get special education aid, and most districts do, and we're getting $2.5 million of special education aid, the same amount this year, same amount for next year. We get transportation aid of $1.8 million. We got the same amount this year, we're getting the same amount next year. We get some security aid, about $730,000. We get some other state aid, it's classified as, and there's a couple of little aids in there. One of the other state aids is, and they give this to districts that have a high non-public transportation, we're getting $85,000. In additional other state aid to help support our non-public busing. This year, we got $130,000, so we're seeing a reduction next year of $45,000 to $85,000. And we did get some additional state aid because we got some park readiness aid, $40,000, and some per pupil growth aid of $40,000. We also received extraordinary aid. Extraordinary aid is for special education, and it is for those students who require services or placements that are greater than $40,000. You apply to the state has a big pot of money, and they split it up among those districts that are applying. You never get the full amount of what your course might be over the $40,000 per student, but it does help. We have been getting, at least on an average for the last couple of years, $1,050,000. So that goes into the pot as well. So that all makes up $6.4 million, which is a great help to the districts. It's almost 7% of revenue. So between that taxes and the revenue, you're pretty much almost done with your budget. We get a small amount of money from federal sources, and it's only $58,170, and this is from the SEMI. This is the, it's called the Special Education Initiative, and it's for, it funds services for needy students, Special Initiative Medication Services. And that is 0.1% of the budget. Then we have a budgeted fund balance. That means we had some surplus monies, and we're going to throw that into the mix of $1,084,890. Now that is only 1.1%, but if we didn't have that money, we would be looking at another $1 million in reductions. Now, we're putting this in, and we're taking our surplus down to a minimum of $250,000. That is the minimum requirement under the law for school districts. Usually a district this size should have 2% of its general fund budget, which would amount to about $1.8 million. So our surplus next year is going to be a rather tight year. Miscellaneous revenue, about $338,000. And that is made up of unrestricted miscellaneous revenue. That would be prior year tuition funds, rental fees, interest. And we always like to lowball that because you can plug a big number in that, but if you don't get it, your budget's going to be short. So it's always better to err on the lower side. If you get any additional money, then it is extra revenue, and it will help on the end with some fund balance later on. Also, we are expecting some tuition. $93,000, $93,205,000, I think, and this is for tuition. We have some students that are funded by the state, so they pay us tuition to educate these kids. And we're going to have a transfer from other funds, which is our capital projects fund, of $650,000. That will go in to make this budget whole. Now, I want to move on to the revenues. This is kind of where our revenues come from, and I have, of course, we went from 13-14, 14-15, the changes in 15-16. Our general fund tax levy, of course, is capped at 2%. So that only realizes $1.6 million. But we have some bank cap available. Bank cap is money that we didn't use previously. In the last few years, you may not have used the 2% cap, or you may not have had any. You may have had a flat budget. But when you do that, you get to bank that money if you need it later on for a certain amount of time. Well, they had bank cap, and there's bank cap available that can be used of $1.8 million. So we're using that bank cap for this year. So the tax increase will not only be a 2%, it will be 2% for the regular general levy, and at 2.25% for the additional bank cap. So this budget is 4.25%. Again, and there will be no future bank cap available as we move into 16-17 or 17-18. Now, our general fund budget for next year will be in excess of $92 million. And that those are the funds that will move the instructional program and support those other extracurricular programs that this district offers. Our expenditures. And you got a couple of big pieces of the pie there. Of course, that big pie, that green one there, this is district salaries. And district salaries alone, 49.7%. So even before we start talking numbers, 50% of that pie is already spoken for. And then we go over there to that orange piece of pie, and we see 13.9%. And that is your health benefits. So right there and then 65% of the budget is spoken for before you start to put your numbers together. Then if you move with your special education, which is another 11.9% of the budget, your budget's nearly done. So you have very, very little to play with in the end. And when you put the budget together, the focus has to be on preserving the instructional program or having the least impact on the instructional program. This is the expenditure chart. And again, this talks about district salaries at the top, which is $45.7 million. That's all your district salaries. And your benefits is your next one, almost $13 million for benefits. Your special education course, this is not including salary, this is just programs and out-of-district placements, $11 million. And you move down to general administration, which has been cut severely, down to $1.5 million. You have central administration, $4.5 million. Other support services, athletics, guidance, nurses, $600,000. Technology management in the district, $872,000. Operation and maintenance of plant, $4.3 million. Student transportation services, almost $4.4 million. The school budgets, $750,000. We have a large transfer to charter school, $5,191,475, just to the charter school alone. That makes up our budget for this year. We have a capital outlay of $663,127. Part of that does include the lease purchase on our new roofs, which the first payment will be due next year. On the bottom, we have Fund 20. Fund 20 is special revenue. It receives the funds for grants. It doesn't require a contribution from the general fund. Whatever we get in, we pay out. If we don't spend grant money, we give it back. It has nothing to do with the tax levy or the general fund. It is just used for programs, and they are grants. They could be from federal or state grants. Then, of course, you have debt service. And the debt service is beginning to go down because the district is paying off its debt. So from this year, it has gone down from $1.9 million to $1.5 million. So, and it's going to go down again next year because you're beginning to pay those debts off. I put this chart up here to show all of the staffing, not only the district employees and their salaries, with the cost of their health and other employee benefits, but the outsourced staffing, which is going to cost over $5 million. So when you take all of the people that will make up the personnel of our district, you're talking almost 70% of the funding of this budget will support personnel, $63,705,470. Now we had to make this budget whole. So we had a very painful process of identifying where we were going to take this money from. Because usually you start out with a wish list, and you get a budget, and then you take your revenue. And of course, you can never squeeze the expenditures into the revenue, so it means you have to trim off the expenditures. And in arriving at this, and this was a very painful process that went on for the last 2 months, as you know, we've had several meetings, and many discussions over this as to where we were going to take those reductions from. So it was not arrived at in any easy process. We have breakage from retirements, which we're using. We're outsourcing our lunchroom aides, 32. We already have 15 outsourced, so there will be 47 outsourced next year. We are going to fund 30% of those 47 salaries from our cafeteria fund, which is a very full fund, Fund 61, for next year. We are outsourcing an additional 38 paraprofessionals. We are reducing the teaching staff by 10 positions. We are reducing our secretarial staff by 5 positions. And we are reducing our non-certificate administrative staff by 3 positions. As I said earlier, we have reduced the general admin budget by $95,000. We've reduced some partial funding of health benefits, and we've reduced capital outlay in the areas of technology and by not purchasing a new vehicle that was scheduled to be purchased. So by doing all that, then we were able to make this budget whole. This is an estimated tax levy recap. Your estimated general fund tax levy increased to $267.60. Since the debt service is going down, there will be a slight reduction in the debt service of $27.89. So the estimated annual increase, $239.71. On a monthly basis, $1998. And this, of course, is on the average assessment of $455,000. This, of course, is the budget resolution that we will be placing before the board to approve the final budget so that we can move forward. Budgets have to be approved at this time so that the tax levy can be generated. And I think the date is May 19th for that. But again, I want to thank the board for all of their hard work and the committees. We struggled through this in the last 6 months, although I've only been in Teaneck since January 28th. I feel like I've lived here for 30 years. Anyway, we got here not without a lot of pain, not without a tremendous amount of discussion as to where these reductions needed to be taken so that we could best preserve the instructional program. And I think we've accomplished that. That concludes my presentation.
Thank you again, Dr. Fraunapple, and I think we can really appreciate the fact that, as he mentioned, he's only been here since January, but it feels like a very long time. Because, you know, it's very challenging, and we as a board have asked, you know, 50,099 questions, and I looked at this, you know, 10 ways till Sunday to try to see, well, can't we find any additional money? You know, don't you know people in the state? Can't we get any special compensations? But unfortunately, it is what it is. But at this time, we would like to open up. I know we have exhausted. I don't know if there's any further comment, but we would like to open up for brief time of public comment if there's any other questions or comments on the budget that haven't already been stated. Okay, just again, please state your name, your address, and 3 minutes, and we will just have a brief discussion at this time.
Joe Petrillo, 706 Northumberland Road. I'm going to keep my comments very, very brief because I walked in a little late with my wife and the discussion was already around the paraprofessionals. And that's obviously, you know, our biggest concern with our daughter in the Bryant School and being diagnosed with autism and the services that she needs. It's tough. You know, we're like Dr. Fraunapple, which I love his name. I say it to myself all the time. You know, we're new to the town as well. Candidly, I had my reservations about moving to Teaneck, and I shared this with you in the last meeting. Much like any parent, dropping your child off at school for the first time is tough on you, it's tough on them, right? But now, your child can't tell you how her day was. She can't share with you how she's feeling. You have to place, as difficult as it is for them to develop trust, you have to develop trust in the individuals that you're handing your daughter off to or your son. Some of you have mentioned that you've had children in the system. Maybe you still do. I don't know. I don't know if any of you have children with special needs or not. But the challenge is massive. It's massive daily. You know, I thank God every single day that we've had the opportunity to come to this town and that we've been able to meet the people that we've met and that they've taken us in the way that they have. And the level of service and care that my daughter's received at the school from her teachers and from the paraprofessionals. She has a vocabulary now. She's potty trained. She's making progress every single day. And this is because she's developed trust and consistency. Mr. Rose, you mentioned quality, that we can't really measure the quality. You know, it could be better, it could be worse. But the reality is, I know what it is that we're getting now, right? And I'm not really willing to compromise on that. And I understand and can empathize with your position. I'm in a difficult position myself in the industry that I'm in. You know, we're not making money, we're losing money. You know, and I'm faced with a lot of difficult decisions when I run our business. And it's tough. We utilize outsourcing companies. Unfortunately, we have seen our level of service degrade. You know, I've been in the schools, and you know, I took the week off last week, and you know, I decided to stop in and check a few things out. You know, and I had some concerns. You know, I feel that if my daughter's in a class where she is learning to speak and communicate, that the teachers in the class or the individuals in the class that are there should be able to effectively communicate. Wouldn't you agree? And if they can't, that's kind of a problem. And these are the people that are trying to encourage language out of my daughter. Kind of an issue. One of the other things that was a massive concern to me when I walked in was the fact that the teacher that was in the class was not an ABA certified teacher, was not a special needs certified teacher. She was a sub, which she's a certified teacher, which is great, but that says to me, wow, there's really a need for more of these teachers in the system, and now we're losing more people that have the experience, that have been there working with these kids because of the budget constraints. So totally understand that you have to make the tough decisions. I completely realize that. I'm in the same boat, unfortunately. But this is the one segment of the school system that needs your help the most. And in a lot of cases, they don't have a voice to say, hey, I'm doing better, I'm learning, I'm happy, right? The only thing that we can do is go based off of what it is that they're showing us. You know, and as parents, it's difficult every single day. Like I said, I don't know if any of you have children with special needs. I never in my wildest imagination thought that I'd find myself in this situation. Believe me, it's tough. And it's heart-wrenching every single day that we go and we drop her off at school and we just wonder, how's her day gonna go? But it's with confidence because we know that the people that are there, they care for her. They treat her like she's their own kid. You know, we've gotten to know them. And it's that trust and belief in them that has us here tonight to come and speak to you. So I know you've got to make tough decisions, but please really give consideration to the fact that the paraprofessionals at the Bryan School are working with special needs children. Thank you.
I just want to please reiterate to please give consideration to the 3-minute limit.
I set my stopwatch.
Wonderful.
Thank you. Hit start. I'm here just because I feel like if I don't express... Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm Regina Melnick. I'm a teacher here in Teaneck at Teaneck High School. I live in Garfield.
And we do that for the recording purposes. We,
sure,
of course, know
sure.
who you are.
No,
thank you.
Yeah. I feel compelled to not just address you, but address my fellow teachers, the members of the Teaneck community. I feel like Teaneck really is my home. I spend way more time here than I do at my house in Garfield. My son was born at Holy Name Hospital. Everybody who means anything to me really is living in or from Teaneck. And the reason that I ended up in Teaneck was around the year 2000 when I was looking for a teaching job. There were three different districts that really, well, two that really wanted me, and then I really wanted Teaneck. And I thought very hard about going to the other two districts because they were like romancing me and recruiting me, but I wanted to be in Teaneck even though I knew that it was very competitive. And I wanted to be in TNEC because of the culture, because of the academic freedom, because of the arts. I remember when I was working here, maybe for about 4 months, I just ended up strolling into the auditorium and I sat down and watched, it might have been Terpsies or Dance Ensemble, and I just knew I was in the right place because it was beautiful and it was incredible the opportunities our students have had. Since I got my job in 2001, I've watched our television studio go, our film production program go, our industrial arts program go. I've watched our AutoCAD programs go. I've watched our computer labs being used for about 40 days out of the year for standardized tests. I've watched now our middle school dance program go, and I think that for a lot of students, that's where they get the skills and courage to be involved in our dance program at the high school. I'm pretty sure that most of you walked in here knowing how you're going to vote tonight. I remember a few meetings ago, Artie Walzer said clearly over and over again, there are going to be cuts and taxes are going to go up. So I think all of you really walked in here knowing how you're going to vote. But you still have an opportunity, even if the budget is passed the way it is, to say publicly, this is not acceptable, because eventually teachers like me who want to be in the best schools will not look at TNEC, they'll look at others. Thank you.
Good evening, Todd Murphy, 1277 Alicia Avenue. Community member. I've had two children educated in the TNEC school system who are graduating college this month, so I'm very proud of them. I'm an educator in the Fine and Performing Arts Department. I'll try to keep my comments brief. When I was hired as a theater teacher in this district, I sought to teach my students that the arts, that by studying and engaging in the humanities, they can educate themselves about the trials and tribulations of mankind, that they can enlighten themselves and their peers via performance on societal and personal issues that affected them and their community, that they could empower themselves by merely using their voice to ask questions, to raise issues of importance to them. I wanted them to know that the arts weren't just an elective subject, that one could shape who they become and the society they choose to live in. Over the past 9 years, I've been honored to work on various productions at TNEC High School. One of our productions, In the Heights, led to the first encore performance in this district in more than 30-some-odd years. The production involved many of the students I instructed at Benjamin Franklin when I first started here over 9 years ago. I stand in awe of the developed talents and the dedication of the arts to all our students over the years. Our recent production, Little Shop of Horrors, involves several students, again, that were in my seventh grade drama class years ago at Benjamin Franklin, who are now graduating, going to college to further their development as artists. I don't think I need to tell you guys that students who study the arts are 4 times more likely to be recognized for academic achievement, that they're 3 times more likely to be awarded for school attendance, that the arts programs are mandatory in countries that consistently rate among the highest in math and science, that art promotes creativity, sound development, personality development, self-worth, everything. I don't think I need to tell anyone here that. What I think I do need to say, and what I think we all need to think about, is the role of the arts and humanities in the lives of our students in this district. To think about eliminating or reducing students' options to create something outside of themselves and to discover something about who they are. I implore you to think about this district with the things that make it unique and about the students who are graduating this year and who want to go on to a successful art career. I want you to think about those students who may not have that opportunity because we chose to eliminate it. I thought about that, and I realize as I tell my students I need to raise my voice and speak out, just like I teach my students every day in this district. I want us all to think about that we're only as good as the lessons we teach our students. Are we telling them the arts aren't important? Are we telling them that the humanities are not important, that they need to create something that is outside of themselves, is not important. I think we need to really think about what we're eliminating here in terms of humanities and arts. I just want us all to think about that before we act on that. Thank you.
Hi, Linda Harrison, TNEC teacher, TNEC taxpayer, Terhune Street. I just want to say that, first of all, I'm not speaking as a TTA member tonight. I'm really speaking as just a citizen of the United States, of a citizen of TNEC. I'd like to separate that because I know I've had a face in the union in prior years, and that's not where I'm coming from tonight. I'm coming here because I believe that public education is the foundation for everybody. It lays the leveling playing field for every kid that's coming into our schools. When I first came to TNEC as an interviewee, your motto was everybody teaches and everybody learns. And when I look back at my philosophy recently, going back to 1999, the first sentence in my teaching philosophy was everybody teaches and everybody learns. And I think that we have not only a fiduciary responsibility as a citizen, I believe that we have a fundamental responsibility as taxpayers to pay for that responsibility, but we have to be able to support kids and an ongoing evolution of our citizens to be able to be a informed participant in our democracy or republic, as however you may want to take that. And I think that you have people here that are so unbelievably great. And it doesn't just stand for the teachers. It stands for our administrators. It stands for our lunch teachers. I call them lunch teachers. You call them lunch paraprofessionals or lunch aides. We've talked about that, right, philosophically, that they should be called lunch teachers because they deserve the respect from our kids when they're in charge of that class, right? And we have really worked hard over the years to try and provide a level of education from kindergarten, pre-K, all the way up through, where we're going to have outstanding citizens, no matter where our kids are coming from, right? They could be talented and gifted. They could be special education. As educator, as TNEC taxpayer, as citizen of TNEC, that's what I am about. And that's what most of our people here are about. And I know that you have had a really hard time coming to this budget, looking at it. But I would really just earnestly say to you, you have a fiduciary responsibility to the people that work for you, because we work for you. I'm a taxpayer. I pay my own salary. I always look at it, I don't have kids coming into the school district. But y'all have a fiduciary responsibility to look at that budget, to look at what's going on, to look at what the needs are, and to look at where we're going to go as a community. What are we doing? What is our future? You can't look at 2011, 2012, 2013 and say, okay, you know, we had to make cuts, we had to do this, we had to do that. We're in a new contract, we're going to be negotiating again for a new contract. It's going to be hard. We have to come together and work this out as a community, as educators, as a board of education, and we look to you as our leaders. I look to you as my leader. And again, I'm not speaking for the union. I take that. I would just want to make that clear. I'm not speaking as a TTA representative tonight. I'm speaking as someone in the community who pays taxes. When I came to TNEC in 1999, I bought a house in TNEC because everybody teaches, everybody learns. It was a diverse community, and I love this community, and I want to move forward in this community, and I want to put years here in this community. We have to find a better way to work together and come to a better agreement for everybody, because that's what's important, our people in this community. Thanks.
Zeb Darrick, Johnson Avenue. I'm a parent of a Hawthorne school student, and but I'm also a taxpayer. And I just wanted to communicate that the 4.25% tax increase is going to have consequences on the community. And I know personally my family is considering moving out of TNEC because of the high tax rate. So, and the fact that you guys went to the very last dollar of the bank cap and 2% increase and we're unable to find any savings below that, does not bode well for next year, whereas I see no path for achieving the 2% next year without either, as the board likes to use the term, draconian cuts, or going to the town for a vote, which everyone's opposed to due to the formalities of the November date. So I know you guys have been making very difficult decisions, and it's not easy, but you also have to recognize that the tax increases are going to affect the community as well. Thank you.
Okay, that concludes our public participation. And at this time, if there are any board comments or closing statements that anyone would like to make? Anybody? Clara? Shelley? David?
Okay, a couple of points I just wanted to make. One, although I support this budget, I have never supported outsourcing. Having to do this impacts our community, and I've even had not someone personally, but one of my neighbors ended up having to sell their home because they were an outsourced person. So I feel it. But at the same time, we're trying to maintain the quality of the school district. Just this past Saturday, I was down in Princeton with a group of school board members from all over the state. And, you know, we were talking, there were some comments that were made, such as, you know, the school funding formula that New Jersey has is one of the best and a fair funding formula in the country, and one of the fairest. And it's underfunded right now to the tune of $5 billion. Every district in New Jersey has either reached the tipping point or last year or this year, or they're going to reach it next year. And so it's become a critical issue, the underfunding, and we're not going to get, we don't see us getting the money. Although, you know, they may decide to fund the formula a little bit more than they did in this past year, because this past year they did flat funding, which is if your expenses are going up proportional, you know, going up as a percentage, flat funding is a loss of funding. And they gave us $10 per student for technology. And everybody knows that we had to put a lot of funds into the technology in order to take these the new park testing. So all of that is hitting all of the districts at the same time. And we were talking, you know, amongst ourselves, we were saying that, you know, there was a time when we used to go to these quarterly meetings and discuss about initiatives that we could bring to the district or that, you know, focused on education. Now all we talk about is finance. That's absolutely all we talk about. And then also what we do, there are other things that are underfunded or unfunded that are coming down, such as new teacher certification requirements that are going to, again, put more stress on the districts. Ethics items that are making it less friendly for parents and teachers and to volunteer. And it's just, I mean, we're really doing the best that we can. And We argue, we spend a lot of time discussing what, you know, this budget and making these cuts. There are a lot of initiatives that we would love to see happen and come to the district. Technology is one of those areas that we wish we could fund. Pre-K. I just want to say that, again, we couldn't come up with any other alternatives. We will always keep our children's safety and the quality of their education in the forefront of every decision that we make, but we have to make certain decisions, and we hope that we will continue to have a dialogue and continue to work with you. We heard you about your concerns about the paraprofessionals, and as our superintendent has assured us that professional development will be given to any of these paraprofessionals that are working with our students, as well as a close scrutiny of all of our educators. And I just want to say that, again, I'm a taxpayer. I went through the Teaneck Public School. I educated my family through the Teaneck Public Schools. I don't have a child in the Teaneck Public Schools, but I am determined to make sure that your students still get the best education that they can.
Good evening. I just wanted to say that although I missed the last board meeting because I was out of town due to a conference, when I returned, I did speak to a few of my colleagues here on the board just to find out if they had come up with any new line items that could possibly be cut. And unfortunately, due to the limited funds, as Ms. Pinsak mentioned earlier, they weren't able to come up with anything different from the past couple of meetings. And it is truly heartbreaking to hear that personnel as well as non-personnel items do have to be cut from the budget. And like Ms. Williams stated, I too came from or am a product of the Teaneck Public Schools. I have a daughter who is graduating on June 23rd. Thank you, Lord. But, you know, I think we both had a great education here in the Teaneck Public Schools, even though we came through in two different eras. Things were cut between the time, obviously, that I graduated and when she's graduating in June. And unfortunately, due to limited funds, I think things will continue to be cut just because of the world that we live in and the limited funds that we are given. But, I mean, just believe that we are doing the best that we can with the funds that we have, and we will make sure that our kids here in Teaneck will continue to get the best possible education. Thank you.
This, as a member of the Finance Committee, I've been living with this budget for more time than I care to think about at the moment. And unfortunately, it is the worst of all possible worlds that I can see. I plan to support the budget because I think it is the best that we can do given the circumstances that we're under. But there is we're caught between Scylla and Charybdis in many respects. We have a fiduciary responsibility, as many people have said here tonight, to fund the education of the of our students, both in terms of personnel and in terms of providing programs. We also have a fiduciary responsibility to the township to do that in as fiscally responsible a way as possible. And we have major financial constraints given what the current tax structure is. And, you know, we've had, we were fortunate over the last several years that we had three charter schools that did not open, so we wound up having significant fund balances that where we were able to defray some of the added costs over that time period, but those but that has not been the case the last 2 years, and we are now in the same spot that many other districts have found themselves in over the last 1 to 2 years, and that is that we're in the inglorious position of having to both raise taxes to a significant extent and to cut services to a significant extent. My personal feeling about this, I find it in some ways reprehensible because I grew up as a public school student, not here in Teaneck, but in St. Louis, Missouri. My children graduated from the Teaneck school system. They are now, one's a third year medical student, the other one is a teacher in San Francisco. They're both doing extraordinarily well, and they owe a lot of that to the education that they received here. I am firmly committed to public school education. I personally find the way that public school education is being attacked in multiple different spheres to be, well, decency prevents me from using the word that I would normally use at this particular point. But in any event, it's something that should not be, that we as a society shouldn't tolerate. I do think that we have to, and I will pledge to work toward this, we have to find a different way of funding education. The whole system of funding education on property tax, based on property taxes, dates back to the 1700s, 1800s, when only property owners' students, property owners' children received education. That hasn't been true for 150 years now, and we need to fund education out of a different pool. We also need to realize as a society that education is truly the leveler for people in this society. And we can either, we have a choice here. We can either pay for education now, or we can pay for the consequences of not educating people later. I will guarantee you the cost of paying for that later is going to be far more than what it is now.
While I'm unhappy, while I'm unhappy with the board and its impact upon students, staff, and the community, having raised taxes, diminished services, I want to compliment my fellow Finance Committee members, the board at large, for literally doing the best that it can do. Nevertheless, I am unable to support the budget. I will, however, along with my fellow board members, strive to do better next time around on a continuing basis. Thank you.
Sarah, sorry. It was interesting listening to everybody talk tonight. I mean, I have to be honest, I'm not happy about taking property taxes up and using the bank cap. I'm not happy about the cuts we have to make. I'm going to vote for the budget because I think it's the best we can do with the system we have. But I completely agree with everything David said. I think funding public education from property taxes is proving to be very destructive to public education. And I also have to say that I feel, you know, we all talk about we love democracy, we love the United States. Well, I don't know how you claim to love democracy and not be a supporter of public education. Because if you don't do a decent job of educating your children, how's democracy going to work? You're going to have uneducated, you know, uninformed people voting. Not a good idea. So I'm not happy about any of it. I'm going to vote for the budget because I think it's the best we can do under the circumstances. I think we do need to start doing some work to figure out how to get public education funded differently, because the way it's going now, this just isn't good. And I guess the last thing I would say is, you know, I truly am not happy with the cuts that we're having to make to get to this number. I would ask for all of you who
expressed concerns as parents about the outsourcing of the paraprofessionals to have some faith that our district superintendent and her staff will do everything in their power to make this work to the benefit of the kids. I know that they are a very committed team and will do everything that they can. So, you know, let us have faith in them and their abilities to do that. But I truly am committed to public education, and I'm not happy that we're making these cuts.
Good evening, everyone. As chair of the Finance Committee, I want to thank everyone on this board for their time and effort, as well as the administration for their support and also, you know, working together. It has been a very difficult budget. It is a process that we started back in November. It is now May. I even forgot the day where we are now. It is now May, so it has been a very long process. Having said that, I don't want tonight to be the end of that process. I want this to become the start of a process that will help not only the Finance Committee, but the board and also the community to come together and really decide how are we going to fund education in this district. You know, I know David talked about, you know, changing policy, legislature. You know, we all could be dead by the time any changes come. So I think we need to find, you know, come together as a community and really decide not what's more important to you, but what sacrifices are we willing to make sure we don't continue to affect the education of our students. You know, I do believe that after 88 staff being affected in this budget, it's a lot of people. Like Ms. Milnick said, the last few years have been a reduction of effective programs in the district, and all that has an impact on the education of our students. It's hard to make an argument when we see test scores and wonder why test scores are not as high as we would like them to be, despite the fact that, you know, there are many reasons why, you know, mainly, you know, the state changing regulations in, you know, every year and so on and so on. But it's also hard to make a case when you continue to remove programs from a district that have a meaningful effect on the education of our students. So that is something we're going to need to come and agree, and I would like for that process to start tomorrow, immediately after we vote on this budget. We are already looking at flat state aid for next year, not a reduction, but less fund balance on the budget. And I believe, if my calculations are correct, that we're probably looking at a gap of about $2.5 to $3 million, yeah, to cover for next year. So unless we come out and look at the other non-mandated items, which is not that many, you know, that include, you know, nurses, sports, public busing operations, you know, these are all items that are very dear to people in our community, and I expect, you know, a lot of people to come out and try to persuade us, rightly so, as to why those areas should not be cut. But it's difficult because the budget needs to be passed. The budget needs to be a balanced budget, and the only way that could happen is one, continue to reduce personnel, which is not effective. But having said that, there can still be possibilities along those lines. You know, if cuts do not happen in the personnel areas, which is at 49% of our budget, then there needs to be negotiations and negotiation time, you know, to work around, you know, different strategies on how to fund the district, you know. So again, everyone has great ideas, everyone wants to, you know, indicate or persuade us why certain areas should not be reduced, but at the end of the day, I think everyone needs to be committed to be able to sacrifice something, and because it's the only way we're going to be able to have a budget that you know support our students, and you know is difficult. But again, I want to thank everyone for the time an effort, and, you know, hopefully next year when we're here, you know, there are no drastic cuts, and perhaps it's a more reasonable budget to be voted on. Thank you.
So, thank you, Sebastian. Your words resonated with me, as did the words of some of the other board members. And as someone said earlier, we need to be role models for our students. So I prefer to look forward and look at what we have maintained for our children, what we have maintained for our teaching staff members and other staff members, what we continue to maintain. As one of the individuals involved in the tough decisions, very unhappy decision making, I still look at a whole district for next year and in the years to come. And I do also invite all of our staff members, teaching staff members and other staff members, as Mr. McHale and I have done, and other staff members, to really look at what it is that you can give to continue to work as hard as you can for our students, to not give up. Sometimes I hear the word morale, and morale is low. Well, as long as you're looking in the eyes of students and you know that you're in the hearts of students, your morale can be nothing but high. And so let's not, as I know it is with so many of our staff members. So I'd like to see that across the board. My feelings are certainly, while saddened about this budget, I know what we've been able to maintain for our students for next year and in the years to come. And Dr. Frohnapple, I just want some clarification, if you can give it to me. If this budget, which is an amount of money, the budget is an amount of money, does not pass this evening, and we are not able to do, does it go to the county for the county superintendent to do with, you know, as the county superintendent sees fit? Would you clarify for me?
Yeah, I'd be down at the county office in the morning asking the county superintendent to strike the budget.
So the budget could not be higher because we're already at the ceiling. Is that correct? That's correct. We can't go higher. So the budget might be lower because we are over adequacy. Is that correct? TNIC is over adequacy. Okay, I just wanted all the board members to understand that, and I think it's good education for all of us. The amount of the budget, this is what happens if it doesn't pass, and I believe people should vote their conscience.
Thank you, Barbara. I think that was a very important point of clarity in terms of adequacy, and that's not a number that we've looked at recently, because we feel that our budget and our students deserve far more than adequacy. So God forbid if it goes to the county, the consequences would only be far greater. And, you know, and I appreciate, Barbara, also you looking at the bright side, looking at what $95 million does afford, as opposed to looking at the cuts, because I know to us that's really what we've been looking at. And also the point of clarity that Sebastian brings us to in terms of the importance of working together, because next year, the fact that we're using our bank cap, we are already looking at probably being at $1.8 million at cuts, because we will no longer have that bank cap, which we are maximizing this year. So it really does behoove us to start now, starting tomorrow, to work together, because some of our teachers, Ms. Harrison, Ms. Milnick, talked about working together and where are we going, where does the future, you know, lead us. And I really appreciate the optimism, and the reason why we're all here is that we are looking at optimistic futures for our children, but the financial side of it doesn't look so optimistic. So that is troubling. And I just want to mention, personally, I know that there was a parent that asked about the special education and the cuts. A few years ago, they were talking about the para cuts, and being a parent of a special ed student, I know how important the paras are, and we asked at that time that we try to look at using the outsource in increments, that we do it on an incremental basis in terms of people that were leaving and trying to kind of like as a trial basis. And that has given us the opportunity, I believe, to work with this current outsource company and perhaps change things that we're not happy with. Hopefully, our best and brightest, and we do really appreciate and value our paras, some of them who I know have taught my children personally, that they would remain with the district. Unfortunately, I know that it will be at a decrease to them. But even in looking at options, because we said, well, let's eliminate the middleman. Why can't we try to negotiate something amongst ourselves? But even looking at that, what you have to pay in terms of health benefits and pension and because of Obamacare, even that doesn't look like it's bright options. But, you know, being the eternal optimist, the bottom line number, I'm sure we'll have to remain the same, but if there is any opportunity for negotiation or continued conversation and shared sacrifice, I'm sure that we would be open to any options, but the bottom line number is the bottom line number, but any negotiation within that, if there can be shared sacrifice, I'm sure we would be open to any other changes. I appreciate all of you coming out, because this, if there's no other time to come out, it's budget season, which is starts like in February. Unfortunately, as Clara was mentioning, it seems like all we talk about. But this is the crux of what's important. And I guess fortunately, unfortunately, and not tonight, most of us are here that are supporters of public education. Some of these budget hearings haven't been necessarily filled with people that are supporters of public education. So therefore, it really truly behooves us to work together to support public education, which has been stated as the leveling playing field. And in this culturally diverse community, many of us came here for that, so that we would have opportunity to have level playing fields for all of our children here. And I hope that we would agree that it is so vitally important for us to realize that we are the supporters here, and if we don't stand together shoulder to shoulder for public education, we can't expect anybody else to. And we know that they won't. There's community members that don't support public education. So we have to find ways moving forward to work together and supporting people that would desire to stand in these seats. And these are hot seats. It's not comfortable. You know, trust us. And we say this many times, we're all volunteers caring about this community, caring about public education. And just a point of clarity, somebody asked, do we care about all the children in the community? And we do simply because we live here. But our obligation is to public education. Despite the fact that we care about all of our students that live here in this community, we want to make sure that we can live in a harmonious community, that we're not pitting people against one another. So we do try to make those decisions. But our obligation as board members, we take an oath to support public education. So if there's no further comments at this point in time, I just also wanted to reference our legal counsel that was here tonight, Christine Martinez, and thank you for being here and attending our meeting. We don't usually always have legal counsel, but we thank her for her indulgence of us this evening. And if there's no further comments. Oh, really? We would like to have our resolution.
All right, Madam President, I'd like to move Finance and Budget Motion Number 170.
Second.
Okay.
Who seconded?
Sarah.
Okay.
Roll call.
All right, we have a motion and a second to approve the final 2015-16 school year budget. Dr. Duguid?
Yes.
Mrs. Rappaport?
Yes.
Mr. Rodriguez?
Yes.
Mr. Rose?
First a statement. I care. I am concerned. I have a sadness. But I do not despair. We will try to do better. What do you say when the best you can do is not good enough? No.
Mrs. Williams?
Yes.
Ms. Worrell?
Yes.
Mrs. Rice?
Yes.
Budget so moved.
Feel free to make a statement.
I'm so glad, Board. I'm so sorry that you had to have this vote tonight, but I'm so glad you didn't give it to the county to make the decision. So I'd like to clap you for that. And I'd like to give you a round of applause for that. I don't think you realize what would happen if it went to the county. Mm-hmm. Thank you. You get it, right? Mm-hmm. Get informed. Get informed to get educated.
Yeah. Any further business at this time?
Yes.
You do?
No.
Oh. Then can we have a final motion?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Meeting adjourned. Thank you for your indulgence, and please take Sebastian on his offer to start working tomorrow on the crafting of the budget for the future.